A recent report from the Philippine Center for Investigative Journalism shows Vice President Leni Robredo topping Facebook ad spending among candidates in the May polls. She has spent 14.1 million pesos from August to December last year, based on PCIJ's review of Facebook's ad library, with the bulk of these ads going live after she formalized her presidential candidacy. Her spokesperson says the ads were paid for by volunteers. In contrast, former Senator Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. has zero ads on Facebook, but a communication expert notes he has invested heavily on the meme wars and campaigning through political fan groups, community pages, and micro-influencers. To make sense of the candidate's social media spending strategy and how COMELEC should regulate this, we now talk to Dr. Jonathan Ong, research fellow at the Harvard Kennedy School Shorenstein Center and associate professor of communication at the University of Massachusetts. He joins us via Zoom from New York. Good morning from Manila, Dr. Ong. Good evening in New York.
Nice to be here. Thank you.
So what do you make of Vice President Leni Robredo's volunteers choosing to spend quite a considerable sum, 14 million pesos, on ads on Facebook? Why Facebook of all social media platforms?
So this is based on the PCIJ report that looks at Facebook ad spending. I think we can only expect that there will be subsequent reports looking at diverse platforms. So I think distinct for the 2022 elections is that we'll be looking at candidates spending across multiple platforms. And I think the wisest and most strategic campaign will know which platform to use to advance specific narratives. So I think for Vice President Robredo, there's a lot for her. First of all, she has to catch up. Based on the polls, she is trailing. And Facebook is still an ideal platform to reach a very broad audience. So I think what's so central and important for her campaign is to really distinguish what's new this time around. So she is running as an independent candidate, so and trying to distance herself from the Dilawan brand associated with the Liberal Party, which she, of course, has traditionally represented. So I think importante ang Facebook to really distinguish, right? You can see that in her new ad, which ends with a tagline, Kulay Rosas ang ating bukas. So trying to really convey this narrative of hope and trying to reach a broader audience. Iba yung strategy nito from the Bongbong Marcos campaign.
Mm-hmm. Now, to what extent do you think this decision was influenced by disinformation spreading on social media, particularly on Facebook against the vice president? Because we've seen memes calling her Leni Lugaw early on in her VP stint, and Verifiles has found that she is the number one victim of fake news for 2021, while her rival Bongbong Marcos benefited the most. So do you think this was a factor in choosing to go heavy on Facebook ad spending?
So I think that's one reason. So I think attack ads against the Robredo campaign, and she is being attacked by diverse candidates, diba? So when you do an attack ad, you don't do it via a video a message, like a professionally produced video. You do it via parody, via memes that are seeded on Twitter or other kinds of accounts on YouTube, for example. So itong parang attack messaging, better suited siya in other platforms such as Twitter or YouTube. And we have many examples of that, diba?
Mm-hmm. But will this strategy of resorting to Facebook ads work, though? Because Marcos is not using it. You've said in the PCIJ article that he's resorting to meme wars and using political fan groups, community pages, and micro-influencers. Is that a better strategy?
So in terms of strategy, I think it looks more organic and more authentic. And definitely, it appeals to certain demographics. So I think it's important for the Marcos campaign to be using and activating yung communities that they have built up over the years. So what they're doing, for example, under the hashtag Laban Marcos on Twitter. So nag-trend siya on Twitter. So that involved mobilizing different kinds of meme pages, parody pages. Of course, there's money being spent behind mobilization. Pero it's hard to capture in any kind of ad library tool which Facebook provides. So narrow yung pag-capture ng Facebook ad library, di ba? So compared to mobilizing influencers and meme pages. And also, very consistent and effective yung kind of attack messaging when they're being deployed by these kinds of parody accounts. So, hindi lang attack ads against Vice President Robredo, but also attack against mainstream media, for example, attack against the EDSA narrative. So, those are the key points that the Marcos campaign is kind of like ticking each one across multiple platforms. So, and again, hindi siya consistent, hindi siya sapat na gawing professionally produced video on Facebook.
Mm-hmm. And one feature of using memes is deniability on the part of the candidate. The memes could go so low in attacking an opponent, but official candidates can distance themselves from the meme. Is this an advantage?
Absolutely. So meme wars is very strategic in that it evades monitoring and regulation. So it operates in gray areas. Even though we can see na parang some accounts, like networks of accounts, were founded, like people created these accounts all at the same time. And therefore, may mga tells, may mga clues in terms of how they were strategically mobilized from the top down. And therefore, may money involved here. Pero it's still hard to prove. It's hard to capture as compared to traditional advertising, which happens on official pages on Facebook. And I think that's what the Facebook ads library is able to capture kung na-declare siya formally ng particular official pages. And again, meme accounts, even though COMELEC is saying that influencers are compelled to disclose whether there was any financial transactions, but still, they can just say now, oh, we are real fans of a political candidate. So there's a lot of loopholes and gray areas when it comes to influencer marketing, and hindi siya formally captured ng regulation natin ngayon.
Mm-hmm. Let's get to the COMELEC regulations in a bit. But for now, how significant is the battle on social media in the 2022 polls? There's a new report in Rappler claiming that most of the Twitter accounts that made pro-Marcos hashtags trend on Twitter, including the one you mentioned, Laban Marcos, mm-hmm. were supposedly created towards the latter part of 2021. So prior to this one, there was a report that 42% of Marcos followers on Twitter were fake accounts, and the Marcoses have been accused of historical revisionism in social media, although they have denied that they have troll farms. So if these allegations are true, can you actually win the elections by manipulating social media?
So a great question. So when it comes to like media manipulation on social media and troll accounts and mobilization, what are we really talking about? So I think there's one element in your question, which is about fairness. Diba? Na parang, is it really fair that some campaigns are able to actually spend a lot on social media, pero hindi formally reported or accounted for in a responsible and fair way in current ways of regulation, such as ones which are developed by COMELEC right now. So I think it's unfair that troll accounts are being mobilized in this particular way. And again, there are clues such as when accounts were created. So if they were only created right after the filing of the certificate of candidacy, then therefore we can be very suspicious about their intention and the fact that they are being strategically coordinated from the top down. At the same time, I want to say that this strategy is nothing new. Our research architects of network disinformation had many examples of various kinds of historical revisionist narratives which have been in play, not just in the last election cycle na senatorial, but also the previous election cycle in 2016. Where Bongbong Marcos had lost. So we had a lot of examples there, including hashtag Ilibing Na. So if you recall the controversy around the burial of Ferdinand Marcos, diba? So, and then coordinated then, there's a lot of clues na coordinated siya by certain kinds of accounts. So it's unfair campaigning for this to go on. But again, the question that we need to ask is, what are the consequences? And I think that's the big question around some of these policies that COMELEC is developing. May consequence ba kung nag-overspend ka, kung nag-spend ka ng ads even before the official start of the campaign period? So right now it's very unclear about the real teeth behind some of these regulation and policy.
Mm-hmm. The COMELEC did say, though, that they are not able to regulate social media, but they will just monitor the expenses. But the question still, can you consider a contender, a candidate, before the start of the election campaign? Because that's where the question on premature campaigning lies on. And so far, the COMELEC has said that based on the interpretation of the Supreme Court and based on the law, it's really at the start of the campaign season. So how should we look at these advertisements at Facebook, these deployment of memes and trolls, how should COMELEC regulate that?
Yeah, a good question around regulation. And I think there's no magic solution here. So even in the United States, when it comes to political advertising, our legislation is really like falling behind the platforms themselves. But I think moving forward, we need to find a way to incorporate influencer marketing into our definitions of political advertising. So yung influencer collaboration means that existing accounts, yung mga popular TikTokers, popular Instagrammers, binabayaran sila ng mga candidates pero hindi sila na-declare as part of official campaign spends. So I think there needs to be legislation to incorporate some of this. It's hard to do it, but we need to start to have that conversation. Number two is also to support bottom-up research and investigation, such as what PCIJ has done, also what many academics are doing, including colleagues in UP Diliman who are doing a lot of very exciting study monitoring the different kinds of platforms. So ngayon, hindi lang dapat Facebook yung minomonitor natin. We need to be looking at misinformation and also unfair kinds of practices that happen on TikTok, on WeChat, on Viber, including on private messaging apps, diba? So I'm sure, Mike, you have also been messaged by many private groups on Facebook Messenger. So some of these memes sinisid on Messenger and then we see them on Twitter later on. So some of these cross-platform strategies we need to be monitoring them, and that requires a real collaborative effort by academics, journalists, and also our policymakers.
A key question here, Dr. Ong, is how do you define partisan political activity? Because the recent COMELEC guidelines includes that that activity, partisan political activity of social media associates in monitoring campaign spending, but it excludes personal opinions. So there are questions on how can you distinguish personal opinions from partisan political activity of a blogger, for instance. So what do you make of this regulation? Mm-hmm.
So political speech is the most protected kind of speech in our constitution. So I do agree with you that it is very challenging to actually develop legislation that will not create new harms and repression when it comes to political speech our expression of support or dissent against certain political figures. So and that's why I would be much more I would be advocating for more ways of looking at financial transactions. So better ways of tracking campaign finance and where the money trail actually kind of leads. So here, advertising public relations firms are always part of the political machinery. And I think we need to be engaging these firms to be much more transparent and disclose the kinds of collaborations that they're doing. And kasama din sa kanila, dumadaan yung pera sa kanila before it reaches the influencer. So the politician sometimes will have to go through the advertising company, will have to go through the PR firm in order to collaborate with the influencer. So I think there's ways in which that can be part of the monitoring efforts, not only of COMELEC, but also of journalists, academics, civil society.
Mm-hmm. Now, COMELEC guidelines supposedly prohibit micro-targeting or using technology to analyze a person's online usage to preferentially serve advertisements and other information that specifically reflect that individual user's preferences and personality. But how realistic is this, and what are the implications? When you ban micro-targeting, does this essentially mean you're banning all advertising on social media?
Yeah, that's very perceptive of you, Mike. So micro-targeting means, viewers out there, means being able to say that I want to reach specific audiences with this particular post, with this particular video on Facebook or YouTube. So you can create like an ad that will only be seen by people in Bulacan, for example. Let's say if it's a local electoral race. And then you want to kind of like really reach a specific population. So COMELEC had mentioned this, and I'm not entirely sure what the consequences of this are. So in a way, you kind of also hurt local candidates who want to make sure that their ads and their messages reach the demographics that they're actually serving, diba? So, and number two, exactly what you were saying, social media advertising is very popular and effective because it leverages on principles of micro-targeting. So, and here I think the ad library does show us some level of transparency, again, based on people who declare that these are political ads. Pero there's so many that are still able to evade the detection of the Facebook ad library. And I think the COMELEC principles here are very unclear in practice. So they're able to say this in their policy and guidelines. How is it going to be practiced? And the following question is, ano yung consequence kung hindi ka sumunod? When most of the policies that they're already proposing, hindi naman clear kung ano yung consequence. Will you get disqualified? It's not really sure.
Mm-hmm. And how about the regulation requiring that only verified accounts, websites, blogs, and or social media pages may run electoral ads, boost or promote electoral posts? Does this make sense that you have to require your candidates that the social media platforms should verify their accounts?
So I think it makes sense. So the verification protocols enables the operator of these particular pages some form of protection. So kung may attempt, for example, at hacking of these particular accounts, so the platform is able to provide immediate support for these accounts, which are quite vulnerable to any kind of hacking or hate or any kind of targeted mobilization efforts. So my good intention behind this impetus towards verification, but again, it leaves a lot of gray areas and a lot of questions, including yung mga fan pages. So currently, even in PCIJ's report, they included some fan pages who had paid for the ads of Vice President Robredo in their report. So. And if you open that up, na parang looking at fan pages, many politicians will always incorporate the creation of fan pages. So it's again, we're unable to kind of trace which of these fan pages are really fan pages and which are also somehow strategically linked to the official campaign.
Mm-hmm. So for now, what can be done in the immediate period, no, leading to the elections, given that you mentioned earlier that our regulations really lag far behind the advancement in technology? What can the COMELEC do, given the lack of legal framework, for example, for really regulating social media?
So I think COMELEC really needs to be working with civil society. They need to be working with journalists, with such as PCIJ, who has always done very effective campaign finance monitoring. Definitely work with academics who are doing a lot of this monitoring work over the years. We've tracked accounts and narratives across multiple election cycles now. So some of these policies that COMELEC are proposing are sometimes well-intentioned and well-meaning, but again, don't really follow the specific features of social media today. So parang it imposes very traditional understandings of the media in this kind of new landscape social media. So instead, they have to kind of like change that thinking around, diba? They have to adjust to the features of social media. And there's already a lot of researchers who are doing this already. And I think they need to be collaborating more with academics and civil society.
All right. Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us this morning, Dr. Jonathan Ong of the Harvard Shorenstein Center and University of Massachusetts.
All right. Thank you so much.